Spetem et paulum omnes santos et vos fratres, orare pro me, Dominum Deum nostrum. Amen. Indulgentiam absolutiam et remissione peccatorum nostrum tribua nobis omnipotens et misericos Dominus. Deus tu conversus vivificabis nos. Ostende nobis Domine misericordiam tuam. Domine exaudi ratione meam. Dominus vobiscum. Oremus. adorato dei omonis antineos ad divite ed al capo tutio ed amici che tu avere figli e vite come svegnabile chiude tere dei tempi infimi gloria patria e figlio e spirito e santo sigo dera di principio e nuge sempre in secola secolo con canto adorate dei omonis antineos ad divite dei tate sessione e tu avere figli e vite Kyrie eleison. Kyrie eleison. Christe eleison. Kyrie eleison. Kyrie eleison.
Paoli apostoli accorto sensi
Misericordiae, benignitatem, umilitatem, modestiam, patientiam. Tu potandes in vigeme donandes vobis mentibus et sicui salvius alique abet querelam. Sicur et Dominus donabe vobis et aetam. Sur omne adem et caritatem apete quares vinculum perfectionis. E pax e Christi exudit in coribus festris, in qua vocati esis in no corpore e gratias totie. Veo van Christi abitet in vobis abundante, in omni sapientia conducendit et commonentes vos metib sos. Almis in vide canti spirituaribus in gratia cantandis in corridibus festris Deum. Omneque comve facit in verbo aut in opere, omnia in nomine nostri Iesu Christi, gratias Deo et Patri, per Iesum Christum Dominum nostrum. Crescere usque ad messem, ut in tempore messe dicam messorium. Oni jirei aprimu zizane aligate e pasheko zar kombur. Om tvidi gavadin onigadin onigadin. Epistle for today, the fifth Sunday after the Epiphany, is taken from the letter of the Apostle St. Paul to the Colossians. Brethren, put ye on, as the elect of God, holy and beloved, the bowels of mercy, benignity, humility, modesty, patience, bearing with one another, and forgiving one another if any have a complaint against another. Even as the Lord hath forgiven you, so you also. But above all these things, have charity, which is the bond of perfection. And let the peace of Christ rejoice in your hearts, wherein also you are called in one body. And be ye thankful. Let the word of Christ dwell in you abundantly, in all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another, in psalms, hymns, and spiritual canticles, singing in grace in your hearts to God. Or whatsoever you do in word or in work, all things do ye in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, giving thanks to God and the Father through Jesus Christ our Lord. And the Holy Gospel is taken from the Gospel according to St. Matthew. At that time Jesus spoke this parable to the multitudes. The kingdom of heaven is like to a man that sowed good seed in his field. But while men were asleep, his enemy came and oversowed cockle among the wheat and went his way. When the blade was sprung up and had brought forth fruit, then appeared also the cockle. And the servants of the good man of the house coming said to him, Sir, didst thou not sow good seed in thy field? Whence then hath it cockle? And he said to them, An enemy hath done this. And the servants said to him, Wilt thou that we go and gather it up? And he said, No, lest perhaps gathering up the cockle, you root up the wheat also together with it. Suffer both to grow until the harvest. And in the time of the harvest, I will say to the reapers, Gather up the first the cockle, and bind it into bundles to burn. But the wheat gather ye into my barn. There's a couple of announcements. This Saturday is the Feast of Our Lady of Lourdes. Remind also this Saturday we have two meetings going on for the girls, the SAS meeting, 9:30, and also the altar boys. They certainly do need to have some practices. So Mr. Montgomery has agreed to come in on the second Saturday of the month, starting this coming Saturday at 9 o'clock, altar boy practice. We expect the altar boys to be here so that they can improve their serving skills for the greater honor and glory of God, as members of the Archconfraternity of St. Stephen want to do. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost, Amen. But above all these things, have charity, which is the bond of perfection. We all know that no matter what virtues we practice, humility, patience, kindness, generosity, thoughtfulness, consideration of others, The value of those virtues, the merits of those virtues, depend entirely upon the charity, the love of God, which is the driving force behind them. But why is that? Why is it that without charity, everything we do is wasted, of no value for eternity, not supernatural, but self-serving? But charity is what transforms it and makes it merit-worthy, supernatural, pleasing to God, lasting forever in heaven. What is charity that makes a difference? Well, what's different about charity is this. It is the theological virtue that draws us close to God and enables and inspires and drives us to accomplish God's holy will. First of all, it's theological virtue, meaning it's infused by God into our soul as our faith and hope, meaning that it unites us to God directly. But it's about faith and hope because faith unites our minds to God as the truth that we must know. It helps us. Hope unites our wills to God as the goal that we long after and the happiness that we desire. But charity unites our wills to God, not just as our goal, but as goodness itself, as the one that we long to love and serve and give for. And that's why charity is higher. And the proper act of charity is that of true friendship. And what's friendship? A friend is not the same as an acquaintance. We have our acquaintances. We keep contact with them because they help us out, because of what they can do for us, what we can gain or get from them. We might be able to learn something. They might be able to do us a favor. But we get things from our acquaintances. A friend is not the same thing at all. You don't have a friend so you can get something from him. You have a friend so you can give something to him. A friend is one you long to help out and to do things for. A friend is not to get something, it's to give. Friendship is the giving for another. And charity is the friendship with Almighty God by which we long to give ourselves to him. We give him our will. We give him our life. We give him our activities. We offer ourselves for him. And that's why charity is above the other theological virtues. It's entirely self-sacrificing. It's not self-seeking in the least. And more than that, charity is a special kind of friendship. Friendship means not only that we want to do good for another, but also friendship means that we share something with another. You can't have a friend you don't share something with. You share the same interests and activities, the hobbies, the sports, the same school, the same faith, but you have to share something with a friend for him to be truly a friend. But what can we share with God, who is almighty, all-powerful, infinite, everywhere? What do we have in common with God? And that's the miracle of charity, that what we have in common with God is the divine life. It's the life of grace, which he shares out of his goodness with us when he gives his own life to us by grace. It's a sharing in the divine goodness and the divine life, which we have in common with Almighty God. And by charity, then, that love of God, that love of our divine Savior enables us to then share with God that divine life. And what's God's life? Who is infinite goodness and infinite love? It's giving. And it's giving to his creatures. And it's giving to sinners like us. And that's what we share through charity, the virtue of charity. And that's why it is such a precious virtue upon which everything else depends. And why it is that the love of God
and the love of our neighbor are together one virtue. Not two things, but one virtue. So the love of our neighbor, which means the forgiveness of our neighbor and the forgiveness of the insults and injuries and faults that he may have directed against us, goes together with the love of God and is inseparable from it, which is exactly the point that St. Paul made in his epistle when he says we must forgive one another if anybody ever complained against another, so that we can have charity, which is the bond of perfection, which enables us to strive to be perfect men in the image and likeness of God, in the image and likeness of our divine Savior, practicing perfect charity on the cross, giving of himself in the most total manner possible. So charity requires then that we practice that charity towards our neighbor. And that's what gives life to our other virtues. And that's why St. Paul says in his wonderful hymn to charity, charity is patient, charity is kind, charity believes all things, hopes all things, bears all things, suffers all things. Charity seeks not her own. No, doesn't seek its own advantage, profit. It always seeks to give. And the other thing that St. Paul says is, charity thinketh no evil. And that is a fundamental point of the practice of charity towards our neighbor, that it thinketh no evil about others. Because that is frequently the obstacle to our practice of the virtue of charity and stops it growing in our souls. Because it must grow in our hearts. Charity is the virtue that grows. But you might say, how can I grow in the love of God? Charity is a virtue infused by God, is it not? Sure, it's infused by God. Can I give myself charity? No. Can I give myself grace? Clearly not. Can I make myself a friend of God? No, not at all. It's God who makes me a friend of his by giving me the grace and the charity to be his friend and to long to sacrifice and give up for him. Well then, how do I get charity? How do I grow in the love of God? First of all, to get charity, I must be sorry for my sins, my mortal sins, but those mortal sins which exclude the love of God from my soul. God's grace gives me contrition. And then when I have contrition, I receive the sacraments, I receive charity to my heart, the love of God. But then I must grow in that charity. How do I grow in the love of God? First of all, by excluding all deliberate venial sin. Because deliberate venial sin, when on purpose I do something that I know I should not do, light matter, true, I tell a lie, I mean to somebody, I cheat in a small matter, deliberate venial sin. It's an obstacle to God's grace, it's an obstacle to charity. And charity can't grow in my heart. I have to root that out. Then, how can I grow in charity and love of God? Since it's a gift that God gives me, I have to dispose my soul to receive more of the gift of grace, that the love of God might become more intense in me. And how do I do that? I pray for an increase in the love of God. I pray for generosity. I pray for the spirit of self-sacrifice, because that's what charity is really all about. I pray to know and to accomplish the will of Almighty God. Even when I don't want to do it in my selfish part, I strive and I pray for the grace to overcome that old man that's in me. And I perform acts of charity, self-sacrifice. This is, if I have a friend, or let's say a husband marries a wife, she's his best friend, and when they get married, he enjoys her company, but as they go along, he gets to truly love her, which means he will give up everything for her. He's given up his money, his income, his life. He'll die for her, because this is her wife, his wife. And so it is with the love of God. We will grow in the love of God as we learn little by little to dispose ourselves So we make a sacrifice, we make an act of love, we make an act of abandonment to God's holy will. And we do it when it's difficult, when it's painful, when we don't want to. We overcome our resistance and we make the sacrifice all the same. And by making those generous acts of the love of God, we grow in charity and we grow in the love of God. And we should never stop growing the love of God in our whole lives. The Blessed Virgin Mary was filled with the love of God from the very first moment of her existence, when she was conceived without any stain of original sin. But did that stop her from growing in the love of God? Not at all. Every day in her life she grew. And she grew in the love of God when she became the Mother of God. And she grew when she accompanied our Divine Savior through all of his difficulties and pains. And she grew in the love of God at the foot of the cross by that heroic sacrifice that she made. And so likewise, should we long to grow in the love of God. And then what we do has merit and value before Almighty God. And that's the purpose of our life on this earth. One day, a priest friend of his asked the curia of Ars, after he came back, you know, he ran away from his parish once to join the monastery, the Trappist monastery. And he realized that it was a deception of the devil. And he came back, and the priest said to him, what would you prefer? Would you prefer to go immediately to heaven where you could see God and be safe in heaven? Or would you prefer to stay years more on this earth to try and save more souls? And he thought about it for a minute, and he said, the saints are in heaven, are living off of the interest that they acquire on this earth. They can't grow in merits. They can't make any more sacrifices. They can't grow in the love of God. But if here I have to stay on this earth, I can gain more merits and I can grow in the love of God because of my wretched sins. I need to grow in the love of God, he said. I need to stay longer on this earth and do more penance. And he determined that he would get up every morning at midnight and pray the night through so that he would grow in the love of God. St. Ignatius of Loyola was asked the same question. And he gave the same answer. That no. He would prefer to spend more time in this world working for the salvation of souls. But then they said, but you might lose your own soul. There's dangers and temptations wherever you look. Wouldn't it be better just to go to heaven? And his answer was, if we are generous with the good Lord and make sacrifices for others, one thing is for sure, that he will not let himself be outdone in generosity, and he will give us the graces to overcome the difficulties and temptations and to save our own soul. If we love souls, we will love to save our own soul. That goes together. The love of souls is inseparable from the love of God. And the love of God is that love of self-sacrifice. One day, St. Francis of Assisi was sitting down and he started to cry. One of the brothers went up and said, why are you weeping, Brother Francis? He says, I was thinking how much our Divine Savior suffered for me and how he was insulted and rejected by his own. But then I thought, how many men there are who do not appreciate this love and do not love him back and who despise his sufferings and passion and add to the insults. That's what really afflicts my heart, he said. They don't love as Christ loves. And as he was dying, St. Francis Xavier was asked, would you like us to read you a spiritual book to help you have good thoughts? And his answer was, I have before me the crucifix of my Divine Savior. That is my book, because it's the book of divine love. Love offers himself on the cross for me. He's given himself entirely. This is divine love. What more have I to learn? What more have I to imitate but the crucifix of my Divine Savior? St. Francis of Assisi grew then in the love of God until he was ready to go right to heaven. example for us. That we'll find the example of true charity in our divine Savior offering himself on the cross for our sins, for our souls, for the souls of sinners of the whole world. And so, let us be determined to remove from our lives and our hearts all the obstacles to the growth in charity. And the obstacle to growth in charity is, in general, sins against the love of our neighbor. Since it's one virtue, we're not tempted to not love God, but we are tempted to not love our neighbor. And that turns us against the love of God. And that happens not just if we steal from him or hurt him, but so often when we make rash judgments against him. Remember, charity thinketh no evil. But when we make rash judgments, we come to conclusions, we think things that are not true. And then we talk. And then we speak about another's faults. And that, we usually say, oh, some little sin against charity. The true name is detraction and calumny. Detraction if it's true, destroying a man's reputation. Calumny if it's a lie. But it's still a mortal sin to destroy another's reputation by talking about his faults. Even to make rash judgments in my own mind can be a mortal sin against charity. Saint Jerome, one of the fathers of the church, once wrote, we find many men who are mortified, many men who can practice chastity, many men who can go off and join a monastery. But did you ever find a man who did not indulge in gossip or listen to gossip even once? Because this, he said, is the devil's snare and tactic to destroy souls who are advanced in other ways, because it destroys charity in their hearts. And it was so true. St. John Chrysostom, who speaks about gossip also and the sins against charity, points out that we can sin just as easily by listening to gossip as by saying it ourselves. And he points that out, that anybody who gossips is like a man who takes a shovel and turns over the dung. He's turning over the dung. And who would want to get close to such a person? Whoo! Never. And a man, he says, who speaks good things about others, I'm always willing and ready to hear. But a man who speaks critically of others and negatively and talks bad about his fellow man, I will stop up my ears so as not to hear it, because my ears are not used to being filled with mud and filth. And in that, he doesn't really say anything different than inspired scripture, because it's St. James who talks about the power of the tongue for good or for evil. If a man sin not with his tongue, this man, he says, is a perfect man, because the tongue is a small member of the body, but it directs the whole life. Just like the rudder of a ship directs the whole ship, or the bit you place in the mouth of a horse to make the horse go where you want, so likewise is the tongue, and it directs their lives. But the problem is, he says, it's a world of iniquity on fire from hell. That is the problem. With one mouth we will bless God the Father who made us, and will curse our neighbor. It's crooked. So frequently do we commit the sins of the tongue, which are then the obstacle to our growth in the love of God. We don't think about it, but it's a true obstacle. And we cannot bring ourselves to sacrifice and to make true acts of divine love, because we're filled with self. St. Thomas Aquinas, as you know, was a great theologian. And as a great theologian, he was involved in many disputes, controversies. And in fact, in the Middle Ages, that's how theology was developed, though it had disputes on all kinds of subjects. And in the midst of all those disputes, one thing that everybody noticed about Thomas was that he never made any critical remark against a person. He never said anything negative about his opposers. He never criticized the intentions, never even talked about their intentions, simply about the subjects. He never made a rash judgment. And what an example that is for us. Because we also are involved in disputes and arguments. We also have problems that we don't agree with people, but we tend to jump to conclusions and to make judgments about people's intentions. Unlike the saints. And that is an obstacle to our charity. Just think of our divine Savior. When Jesus was dying on the cross, hanging between heaven and earth, with his mind's eye, he saw all of men of all time. He saw all of the sins of all men for whom he is dying on the cross. And what does he say? What's his prayer? He knows all our sins and all our wretchedness and all our faults and our crookedness. What does he say? Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. He finds excuses even for us when we should know what we're doing. But he uses the feebleness and the changeability of human nature, our ignorance, as an excuse for God to forgive us. That's true love. That's practicing what he preached. Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And that's what we must practice too. Leaving the judgment of souls and the hidden secrets of hearts to God alone. Always to presume the best of others, to think that they are well-intentioned, to never talk about their motives, to always find excuses for what they might say or do which may not be objectively right. That is the spirit of charity. And it shows how we're going to imitate our divine Savior on the cross and learn to grow in this wonderful virtue, this divine friendship, this friendship which gives us the life of God himself, who, being all good, gives of himself and gives us, wretched though we are, the possibility of giving ourselves in some little way for others and for God. By forgiveness, by bearing wrongs patiently, and for the love of God. What a wonderful thing is that life of grace, that life of charity that our divine Savior came upon this earth to give to us. May we always grow in that love of God. May we never abandon it. May the Blessed Virgin may obtain for us that fidelity to grace that she practiced, that we might always go forward towards eternity, never backwards. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen.
Dominus vobiscum.
Thank you. Please take the time, Lord God, please. Pick him up.
Orate fratres, omnipotente. Omnia saecula saeculorum.
Amen.
Dominus vobiscum. Domine Sancte Pater Omnipotens Eterne Deus, qui cum unigenito Filio Tuo et Spiritus Sancto unus est Deus, unus est Dominus, non in unio singularitate personae, sed in unio trinitate substantiae. Quod in te tua gloria revelante te credimus, a te Filio tuo, a te Spiritus Sancto, sine differentia discretionis sentimus. Ut in confessio infelis sepite neque deitatis, et in personis proprietas, et in essentia unitas, et in maestate adoretur et qualitas. Quam laudat angeli aque ac angeli, cherubim quoque ac seraphim, qui non cessan clamare quotidie una voce dicente.
Santo, 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 santo,
Oh, Amen.
Agnus Dei qui tollis Indulgentiam absolutionem et remissionem peccatorum vestro contiva vobis omnipotens et misericordiam Dominus. Ecce Agnus Dei, ecce qui tollit peccato mundi, Domine non sunt dignus rentrare sub tectum meum, sed auto dic verbo est in habito anima mea. Domine non sunt dignus rentrare sub tectum meum, sed auto dic verbo est in habito anima mea. Domine non sunt dignus rentrare sub tectum meum, sed auto dic verbo est in habito anima mea.
hope is to be with Jesus Christ.
Hope is to be with Jesus Christ. Hope is to be with Jesus Christ. Hope is to be with Jesus Christ. Hope is to be with Jesus Christ.
Thank you.
Lavando omne things qui poci davanti a voi.
Dominus vobis. Alleluia. Praesimus omnipotens Deus. Con ilius salutaris capiamus effectus. Num cuius virgem ex mysteria pinius accepimus per Dominum nostrum Iesum Christum epinium tuum qui te convivere regnat in unitate Spiritus Sancti Deus per omnia saecula saeculorum.
Amen.
Dominus vobiscum.
Omnipotens Deus, Pater, Filius, et Spiritus Sanctus. Dominus vobiscum. Initium Sancti Evangelii secundum Ioannem. In principio era il Verbo, e il Verbo era tabula Deum, e Deus era il Verbo, come anche era in principio, Padre Deum, omnia veritas, Padre Celestinis, Pactum est Nicico, Pactum est. In ipso vita era luc omnium nos in tenebris lucere tenebre eam non comprehendent. Fuit homo mystis ad Deo cui nome erat Ioannis. I venit in testimonium et testimonium per libere et lumine. Non erat ide lux ero testimonium per libere et lumine. Erat lux fera quae luminat omnem omine venite in ugum mundum. In mundum erat lumus per ipsum facius est mundus eam non cognovit. In propria venit et sui eo non esce perunt. Qualcora te recepemunt eum delites podestare filios et dei fieri, isui credo di nomine eus, qui non ex sanguinibus, neques voluntate carnis, neques voluntate divinis, reis eum natissim. El verbum caro factum est, ed habitavit in nobis et intimus, et gloria meus gloria in quasi unigeniti abate, menum gratiae et veritatis.